this week's broadcast, we talked to Pieter Haasjager from CatTrain about the report revealing where it went wrong on the harbour line of Rotterdam. And we also talked to Tony from North Star Event about the latest development in the Chinese rail freight industry. This is Rail Freight Life. Good afternoon. It's 9 October. Yesterday evening, the second train departed from the port of Rotterdam to the Chinese city of Xi'an. And this connection is part of a recently established service between the two logistics hubs. On 25 September, the first train arrived in the port of Rotterdam. And after being reloaded, it made its return trip to China with milk powder from Ireland. The departure of a second train indicates that the service is to be taken seriously. The Port of Rotterdam already said that the railway connection had whetted their appetite. And there was more good news from the Port of Rotterdam. DB Cargo is launching a new service in which it links the Port of Rotterdam and Antwerp with southern Germany and Austria. The service will start mid-December of this year, and it will link cities such as Ludwigshafen, Mannheim, Nuremberg, Munich and Wolfurt. And according to the German operator, this fulfills a long-cherished wish from the port in the Netherlands. And next week, the Track Access Charges Summit takes place. This online event will be held from this studio on Wednesday 14 and Thursday 15 October. This year's conference focuses on both the regulative and political aspects of track access charging, a topic of great concern to the rail freight industry. And the implementation of the minimum access package and different additional other aspects are other core themes. It has been discussed here many times, the problems on the railway network in and around the Port of Rotterdam. And then there was suddenly the final report that everybody was waiting for. The report is titled "Non-compliant by coincidence or not predictably unfit." And in this report, uncompromising conclusions are drawn on the why of the long-standing malfunctions of the infrastructure. Now, we have Pieter Haasjager from CatTrain on the line. Pieter Haasjager, welcome.
Good afternoon, Mary.
Good afternoon. Pieter, have you already read the report?
Yes, I was one of the lucky ones to read it already before, as I was one of the ones in the steering group which have ordered Crisis Lab for producing this report. So yes, I've read it.
Okay, and can you, if you have to remember one thing that was entirely new to you, what would that be?
Well, one of the things what was new to me was basically that the investments ProRail have to make in order to comply to new regulations of the local authorities, the Veiligheidsregio Rotterdam, as an example, set up new compliances for ProRail, which already for next year means for them to invest, I think it was above 50 million euros. And of course, we all have to pay that. And as an example, what we see now, that we are not able to do the shunting on the Waalhaven because of non-compliance is on the fiber installations over there, has an impact that for 0.000% chance of an accident, whereby now ProRail is paying a lot for a new installation and also a lot to us as customers as a compensation for, well, all the problems we operationally have. And that was really new to me, and I think it's also a good statement to the ministry in order to change that if possible.
Yeah, you said you'll be compensated for all the losses you had at the emplacement yard Waalhaven. Are those also the compensations that you asked for?
No, partly. This is the whole harbour line is a problem, and that is basically what we, as customers from ProRail, already said for many years. That was not new in the report from Crisis Lab, But the fact that that in the compensation we get now is mainly because of the Waalhaven. So we call that the Waalhaven compensations. But we have many other topics on the harbor line. Switches, which are very old, border crossings, the railway crossings, which are basically not working properly. Sand on the Maasvlakte, which is giving us a lot of hassle to enter important terminals. So yeah, we have a lot of other issues as well. That's also mentioned in the report. And we have now said, okay, we need to have, and we agreed already with the ministry to get this compensated. So it's a part of what of the whole package deal we prefer to get. Yeah.
Yeah, and what is the part that is not being responded to?
Excuse me?
You said it's part of the things you were asking for. What is the part that you're where you're not compensated?
No, we are not compensated for all the other topics we have on the harbor line. As the examples I just mentioned, we hardly get any compensation for that. The ministry has now acknowledge, okay, we have so many problems. We have already claimed so many stuff to ProRail, which is extremely difficult to get that compensated. It's a difficult story, but it has, that's a legal an issue. But we have now reached an agreement to look for, well, more general compensations for this harbor line problems. Because also for the next coming years, that we need to restructure and to exchange new switches and new parts will also have a huge impact on our productions.
And what kind of impact do you mean? Which impact do you think this will have?
Exactly. As an example, they need to change, I think, already on the Waalhaven 70 switches, and that will have a lot of problems for us. Because that can only be done when we are not riding trains and we are a 24/7 operation. So that will have an impact.
And are there any alternative routes in place or is there a plan for this?
No, that's the problem. It's one line from Zee to Zevenaar, from the sea to the Zevenaar. Everything to Kaifuk is only one big line. Yeah? And we have, of course, then regions where we can comply. But if you need to go to the to one, like the Maasvlakte, there are no alternatives to do that. So we need to make sure that there are certain periods that they have to work. We understand that they have to do the maintenance and the replacements of the tracks and the switches, etc. But that will have a significant impact. Yeah. So for the next coming years, it will be a problem. Plus that what we already experienced the last year, which is partly compensated.
So we're not there yet. That is for sure. Does this report give you an answer to the why question? Why this was happening?
Well, that's a little bit difficult because you would say it is a money thing, but that apparently was not. That is an organizational problem that do not surprise me. And I think that is the answer on everything. It has to do with culture. It has to do by understanding your customers. ProRail needs to understand the customers. And if you say, okay, we have a completely other business model and other business strategy, like, for instance, the passenger traffic. And I think that needs to be changed. That's also recommended. So understand your customers, spend more time, and focus on especially this harbor line. And that's also one of the recommendations. And that's also one of the things that the board of ProRail acknowledged and is already started to implement.
Yeah. And does this help you in any way that this report was here?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it gives us acknowledgement. I mean, yeah, of course, it's not nice if you as a customer all the time are telling ProRail that the things are not in place. ProRail gets, of course, also annoyed. it was so difficult to cargo guys, but now it has been clearly acknowledged, I think. And that is for us as the sector, and at least for me, definitely a help. It's not about the money, because we lost a lot of money, all of us, the whole sector. We need to grow, basically for the next, Prodas indicated, will take another 4 years before we are in place. But especially the next 2 years, when the physical job has to be done, will definitely give hassle and will not help in order to get more business on the tracks, unfortunately.
Yeah. Now you have gone a long way in fighting this, or at least bringing this to the attention. Do you feel like you and Prodel got closer in this regard?
Yes, I think yes. Yes, the trust is there. The trust now in the new management in top give us trust, but we have to see. For 10 years, there are always promises, yes, we will change. I always say it has to start in top of the tree. In this case, with Hans Rijkstra, for instance, and John Foppa. They clearly try to look to find the connection with us. I think that's good. But of course, we will closely monitor the situation, and that's good. We are in good negotiation or good relation with each other now, and hopefully we can continue this because they started already a year ago this cooperation, and I have faith that could succeed and that we will come closer to each other. Yes. Yeah.
Just, we hope not, but let's imagine that things go wrong and you see that things are not happening according as planned. Do you think you have the right tools now or the right ways to communicate or address these problems?
Let's hope that's not the case. At the moment, that we do not see any improvements, because that's basically what we need to see. Not only the physical improvements on the tracks. As an example, I think 2 weeks ago, I was driving there at night, and then I saw, I think, of four different locations, people working, and that I've never seen before. So I think they are really, on the physical part, they are really doing things now. That's good. It have to be done. It will, of course, take a while before you see trust and before you can see the improvements and customers get the trust back. That is, we are just a transporter, with all respect. Our customers, the industry, they also need to get this trust back. That takes time, and we are all, including Prodel, aware of that. At the moment that things are not going right, then, of course, we will also talk to the ministry. I assume now that the ministry will not let that happen, and I even don't think that Prodel will let this happen. I think it's a wise lesson for them.
Yeah. One last thing. If you could speak to your customers right now, what would your main message be?
Yes, well, our customers at this moment are very hesitating to find the trust. And that is the key word at this moment. We need to get the trust back of our customers. That can help at the moment that the situation stabilizes and that the tracks are running normally again. At this, I think you will see then immediately the change. I think rail is the future. We all want that. There is political willingness that has been not always the case, but we all have problems with the climate. We all have problems with the traffic jams. This is the way forward. So rail is a good modality in order to help. So on that side, everything is on the green, but the harbor line is still red. And I hope this can be orange the next 2 years. Let's aim after 2024 that it is green and that it remains green. And then I think we have a good opportunity to grow to the 63 or the 65 million tons we all would like to have the coming years.
Okay. Thank you very much for joining us, and good luck with that.
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Goodbye. And now, part of the railway network in Rotterdam is the emplacement yard in Kijfhoek. And this yard has also been under fire because the safety is not up to standards and the infrastructure is poorly maintained. But this is about to change. On the same day as the report was presented, a plan was also revealed for Kaifuk. It's the largest yard of the Netherlands.
Op emplacement Kaifuk in Zwijndrecht worden goederentreinen gesorteerd en opnieuw samengesteld voor verder transport naar de Rotterdamse haven of andere grote industriële gebieden in Nederland en Europa. Goederentreinen kunnen van alles vervoeren. Zo zitten er bijvoorbeeld wasmachines in containers en worden auto's, staal, hout, kolen en ertsen per spoor vervoerd. Ook wagens met gevaarlijke stoffen vinden hun eindbestemming via het spoor. Daarom gelden strenge veiligheidseisen voor het emplacement. De gemeente Zwijndrecht, de Omgevingsdienst Zuid-Holland-Zuid, de Veiligheidsregio Zuid-Holland-Zuid en ProRail zijn alert op de risico's en de veiligheid op Kaifuk en spreken daar regelmatig over. Hoewel het vervoer per spoor een van de veiligste manieren is om goederen te transporteren, blijft er altijd een risico op incidenten. Zo brak er op het emplacement in 2011 brand uit in een goederenwagon gevuld met ethanol. ProRail heeft in 2012 op aanwijzing van de gemeente Zwijndrecht een bedrijfsbrandweer op Kaifuk geïnstalleerd. Deze bestaat uit 7 personen en is 24 uur per dag beschikbaar op het emplacement. Zo kan er sneller worden opgetreden. Maar wanneer er midden op het emplacement een incident is, kan de brandweer er echter lastig bij komen. Alle betrokken partijen willen de bereikbaarheid en dus de bestrijdbaarheid van incidenten op het emplacement verbeteren. Het ministerie van Infrastructuur en Waterstaat, de gemeente Zwijndrecht, de Veiligheidsregio Zuid-Holland-Zuid, de Omgevingsdienst Zuid-Holland-Zuid en ProRail hebben gesproken over hoe ze de veiligheid op zowel Kaifuk als in de spoorzone in Zwijndrecht en Dordrecht kunnen verbeteren. ProRail en ministerie investeren op Kaifuk door extra calamiteitenwegen aan te leggen op het emplacement en extra bluswatervoorzieningen te treffen. Daardoor kunnen incidenten sneller en effectiever worden bestreden. De brandweer kan de incidenten beter bereiken. Zo kunnen de bedrijfsbrandweer en de brandweer Zuid-Holland-Zuid samen sneller en gerichter eventuele incidenten bestrijden. ProRail voert deze taken uit met een bedrijfsbrandweer van 4 personen die 24 uur per dag beschikbaar is op het emplacement. Verder investeren ProRail en de Veiligheidsregio Zuid-Holland-Zuid in 3 uitwisselbare schuimblusvoertuigen. Met deze voertuigen kan snel schuim worden ingezet op de brand of de lekkende stof. De voertuigen zijn identiek, zodat beide korpsen de wagens kunnen bedienen. Deze 3 voertuigen worden ingezet in de spoorzone van Dordrecht en Zwijndrecht en op emplacement Kaifuk. Daardoor kunnen ze elkaars reservevoertuig zijn. ProRail beschikt over een gaspakteam om lekkages in goederenwagons te bestrijden. ProRail heeft hiervoor 2 specialisten 24 uur per dag paraat. ProRail roept 4 mensen extra op, in aanvulling op de bedrijfsbrandweer. En als er lekkages zijn bij een groot incident, dan moeten het schuimblusvoertuig en het gaspakteam tegelijk worden ingezet. Als ProRail de opgeroepen mensen dan niet snel genoeg kan inzetten, neemt de brandweer Zuid-Holland-Zuid de inzet van het schuimblusvoertuig over. Hierdoor kunnen de 4 mensen van de bedrijfsbrandweer in gaspak met hun 2 collega's het lek dichten. Daarnaast gaan de beide korpsen gezamenlijk de voertuigen kopen, mensen opleiden, oefenen en kennis uitwisselen over spoorincidenten. Zo versterken we samen de veiligheid op Kaifuk en in de spoorzone.
And we're going to make the switch from the Netherlands to China. And on the line we have Bouvet Zhao, better known as Tony. Tony or Bouvet, what is the name you're better known as?
I think Tony is better. It's easy for you to pronounce it.
That's probably true. And you're based in China. In which city are you based?
In Beijing now.
You're in Beijing. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And you work for North Star Events. Yeah. And we are actually a strategic partner for the European Silk Road Summit, the event taking place in November. We're going to have a parallel session in which we host part of your conference in Chengdu. This seems and looks very exciting. Can you tell us a little bit more about the conference that's taking place at the same time in Chengdu?
Yeah, actually we are the only exhibition focused on the China-EU blockchain and maybe the only one and the first one in China. And we have around 12 concurrent events together with the Europe Silk Road Summit together with you on connection this year. But I do think the Europe Silk Road Summit 2020 is the most important event together with us.
Yeah. And what kind of topics are going to be presented in that 2-hour parallel session that we have with you?
So during the COVID-19 pandemic this year, I think we are eager to exchange points of views and information about the China-Europe blockchain with everybody. The 2 hours online connection will be an ideal platform for them to meet online. And we do expect more goods owners, forwarders, railway station, and the logistics centers could join the connection to share the information with us. We are all eager to recover from the pandemic as soon as possible. So there is a lot of possibilities for us to cooperate.
Yeah, and do you already know something about the speakers in that session?
Yes, we have invited some high officers from the provincial platform companies and from the government. And also we have invited some forwarders for some shipping company this year, because after the pandemic, more and more shipping companies are focused on China-EU blockchain. You know, they have more opportunities to transport their goods to ensure their supply chain during the pandemic. I think this is new to us.
Yeah. And you will also be able to watch us in Amsterdam, or actually not Amsterdam, apologies, in the studio, because it's an online event. What do you think people in China are looking for from our speakers, from our side?
Yeah, we want to more goods owners, forwarders from European, because we want to have more eastbound or westbound goods. And we, the provincial platform company, want to find some logistics centers to distribute goods and collect goods in Europe. This will make the goods go much more faster in Europe.
Yeah. Okay. This is taking place on 10 and 11 of November. It's online, so people can already register, sign up. You will be able to watch both the conference in Chengdu and in the Netherlands. But that's not all, of course. We're not just here to talk about the event. You are there having a good overview of the Chinese real estate market. What do you think are the topics most relevant or new recent developments in China at this moment?
Yeah, in July, the China's Developing and Reforming Committee has published the new subsidy or funding for the 5 assembly center. China-EU Blockchain Assembly Center in China, including Chengdu, Xi'an, Chongqing, Urumqi, and Zhengzhou. And also in August, the Russian government also announced the subsidy to the blockchain from eastbound and westbound. So I think this is the most interesting topic to we are Chinese provincial platform companies and forwarders.
And how should we see those extra subsidies from the Russian government? Is that on top of the Chinese subsidies that already are in place?
Yes, yes.
And that is for both directions?
Both directions, eastbound and westbound.
Yeah. And what does that mean for the price? Do you have any idea about the reductions in terms of percentages?
Yes, that actually is some amount according to the container. It's around 3,000 RMB to 7,000 RMB each from 20 feet of container to 40 container from the different direction, different size is different, but the minimum is 3,000 RMB each and around 7,000 RMB each lever, higher.
Yeah. Okay, so that is good news. It looks like there's a lot of willingness to help traffic between China and Europe. And you said that there are 5 hubs that are going to be supported in particular in China. Do you have any idea why these 5 hubs were selected?
Yes, actually, the policy is by the National Reforming and Development Committee, but It depends on many, many things. For example, when they started the China-EU block trade, and how many TEU, how many containers they shipped each year. But the most important, I think, is the location of the city and the province, and also the support from the municipal and the provincial government. So that's many aspects.
Yeah. And do you agree with the selection of these five cities?
Yes. You know, for example, Chengdu, it in the last 5 years, it is shipped most containers, ranks number one in the provincial platform companies. And for some companies, such as Chongqing, it ranks number two. And for example, Xi'an, it is only started the China-EU block trade several years ago, but the location of Xi'an is very, very important.
No.
So I do think they do deserve the ranks space.
Yeah, but they are also very close together. Wouldn't that mean that there is a lot of concentration in one area rather than having a good spread or distribution of those supported hubs?
Yes. For some small cities, it don't have much potential to collect the goods. Mm. But for Chengdu, Xi'an, Zhengzhou, they are very big cities. And also for Urumqi, the biggest city in Xinjiang and the biggest city in the west region, but very close to Kazakhstan. So why they select these five cities, they have a lot of consideration. I do think these five cities are quite qualified for the assembly centers.
Yeah. And does that mean that from now on, most traffic will be concentrated in these places, or will it still go anywhere in China up to the customer's demand?
For some province, they also have a strong support from the local government.
Right.
But for some province, they have to send their goods to the assembly centers. But I think some assembly center city will make a deal with other cities. But I think it's a good thing. Yes.
Why is it a good thing?
Yes, it can save a lot of energy, save a lot of money, and save a lot of labor. That's a good thing. And it can make the China-EU block trade running more sufficient and more smooth.
Yeah. And the amount that will be spent is 25 million euros, if I'm not mistaken. Is that amount, is that able to change anything?
For Chengdu, Xi'an, Chongqing, almost equal around 5 million. But for Urumqi, it's a little bit higher. For Zhengzhou, a little bit lower, but generally speaking, not so much different.
No. And why do you think that those different amounts were defined?
Not defined. They are also under discussion, right. And many government bodies in such kind of assembly cities also negotiated with the central government for negotiated with the National Developing and Reforming Committee.
Yeah, so currently there's a huge competition going on in China for these extra funds.
Yeah, yeah. I think the five assembly center plan will help China and also the European countries to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic as quickly as possible. I think it's a good thing.
Yeah. Would you say China is yet to be recovered, or where are we now?
Mostly, almost recovered, because I can travel around China freely, and also you can see the national holiday around 750 million people travel around China without restriction.
Yeah.
So I think the China style will help the world, help European to know how to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic. I think it's also a good thing.
Yeah, because you just had a holiday last week, isn't it? Mid-Autumn Festival.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's very good news to hear. We're going to see you again in November for the parallel session.
Yeah.
And thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.
And with that, we've come to an end of this week's Real Freight Live. You can follow us on YouTube, or you can visit our website, realfreight.com. See you again next week. Goodbye.